Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Always we have the expression, may you live in good health. But what if that day of reckoning comes? What happens in death? Where do you go? How do you know where you're going? And what does your family do? If you are Jewish, my guest, Leila Leah Bronner, has written Journey to Heaven, Exploring Jewish Views of the Afterlife, published by Urim Publications. Welcome, Leila.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
Thank you. It is interesting how you begin this book about God being down on earth and about Enoch, who is going to go with him, but it doesn't say he dies.
Yes, well, Enoch is one of the few persons in the Bible, of whom it said, as you mentioned, that he walked with God, but he was no more. So God took him, we assume, to heaven, and he became a very mystical figure in Jewish history and later in Christian history and so on. And another person who never died in the Bible was Elijah. Elijah is another prophet who did a lot of things in his lifetime as a pretty angry young man. But then when he died, we're told that two chariots went apart and they took Elijah to heaven. And he also didn't die, obviously. And therefore Elijah became a very important person in later Jewish history. But in the Bible, he's one of the people who resurrect a boy. And then his follower, his disciple, Elisha, also resurrects the boy. So Elijah and Elisha are connected to resurrection, which also goes into other religions after Judaism, the idea that there is resurrection of human beings.
The event of the Egyptians and their Book of the Dead, did that have an influence at all on the Jews of that time?
Well, it's hard to say. Some people would think yes, some would say no. I don't think so, because I don't think there was such close proximity between this big world empire and the Jews that they should have been influenced. And the Jews didn't embalm people. There's only one case of embalming in the Bible, or as they do, is that Jacob, who went into Egypt, he's embalmed when he dies, and he's taken back to the land of Israel. So these are things you can never know, because the ideas of the Egyptians of death was different to the ones of the Jewish people, which we will discuss on. Yeah. The Jews believed in resurrection of the dead. The Egyptians believed in the continuing life. They build these huge edifices, and there they would put the person who died in with all their supplies for which they would need in the life to come. So there was a more physical belief in an afterlife. The Bible had a more spiritual belief in the afterlife, and the rabbis later of the Talmud even more so. So it's a very interesting question, and people have tried to solve it, but it's difficult to say either way.
You talk about, in quotes, the world to come. Who would go?
That is a very interesting question. The world to come appears in the rabbis' literature already. In the world to come comes in the Talmud, which is Mishnah and Gemara. And I start my chapter on the Mishnah with this, that the world to come, that the rabbis there say, Kol Yisrael yesh lahem chelek la'olam haba, that all Israel will inherit olam haba. But then they go on to say, who doesn't inherit olam haba? Yeah. Showing that sinful people, I won't go into details, won't inherit the olam haba. They won't get there. And that is what a lot of the Talmud is about. How do you get to Olam Haba? What do you have to do to get to Olam Haba? What activities, actions, good actions? For instance, they say that the righteous people of all nations have a share in the world to come. They don't make it exclusive. Only the Jews go to the world to come. No, all people have a share. And that's interesting, because in Christianity, the idea is that when those who believe in Christ will be resurrected. In Judaism, we don't have that, in this case, that exclusive idea. Yeah. We believe, as the rabbis say, all people, they call them chassidei umot ha'olam, yesh lahem chelek la'olam haba. The righteous, chesed means righteous or goodness in the Bible. They say all people who do good will have a right to a share in the world to come, but you have to live an ethical and moral life to get to this Olam Haba. You don't get there just by yourself.
You mentioned about resurrection, and that also the place Sheol, which is hell.
Sheol is not hell. Sheol is the underworld.
Yeah.
It's where the dead go in the Bible. It occurs 65 times in the Bible, the word Sheol, that the people who die go into the underworld, and you wonder, why are they so concerned with this underworld if they're dead already? Yeah. So that makes some people think that the Sheol is a place where the dead got together, and maybe there was some life in them.
Yeah.
And the word Sheol means to ask, which would imply, as you said before, people ask their ancestors.
Yeah.
Now, the Bible doesn't like that, but people obviously did it.
Yeah.
People always do what they're told not to do.
The other part of that is it the body that becomes resurrected or the soul? The soul is very important within Judaism.
Absolutely. It's a very good question. It starts, resurrection starts in the Bible, in the book of Daniel, although the whole question of the life hereafter in the Bible is a big question. I deal with it in my book. But finally, in the book of Isaiah, which is the later part of Isaiah, like chapters 25 to 27, speak about the dead rising and living again. And the famous book for this resurrection, which you ask about, is the book of Daniel. Daniel says that they who sleep in the dust of the earth shall arise, some to everlasting life, some to everlasting damnation. And so here begins the resurrection, and it goes through Jewish history and Christian history, and Islamic. This belief of resurrection began in the Bible but went on to others. It was always felt that it's more difficult to believe in resurrection. For instance, the Talmud never gives a complete description of what Olam Haba is. Mm. They never say, well, it's got furniture in it, it's got windows. They just speak about it as something very spiritual, very, very spiritual. They speak about the righteous sit with crowns on their heads and look at the radiance of God. That is Olam Haba. Now, that's a very spiritual thing, you know? And with that goes the idea also that though they believed in resurrection, they believed also that we know the body dies and disintegrates. Mm-hmm. Everybody sees that. But they said the soul goes up to heaven. There's like a treasury of souls by God in heaven where the souls go to. And at the end of time in Olam Haba, the body and the soul will be resurrected and live. Now, many people find it more easy to believe in the immortality of the soul than in the resurrection. And that's quite true, but both these ideas are taken on in Judaism.
How did the scrolls, the Dead Sea Scrolls, affect thinking as we have thought it through the ages, and now suddenly there with the Dead Sea Scrolls?
Well, the Dead Sea Scrolls impact the history of the Jewish people on the Second Temple. But on the question of the life hereafter, it's very questionable. I mention in my book two places or three that the Dead Sea Scrolls might be speaking about immortality or resurrection. Yeah. Otherwise, they don't speak about it too much. Maybe when we uncover all the scrolls, we'll find more. But meanwhile, they didn't, because we think the Dead Sea Scrolls were either the Pharisees or the Essenes. Or they were a different sect that we don't know who they were. It could be that the Dead Sea sect didn't worry about the life hereafter somewhere. We don't know enough about him. The Pharisees, who became the rabbis in Judaism, believed in the resurrection of the dead. The Essenes believed in immortality of the soul. So you have the whole panorama. If you look at the Dead Sea Scrolls, you'll think about the Essenes, who are not mentioned in the Talmud, or they're in Roman sources, not in Jewish sources. They believed in the immortality of the soul. The rabbis believed in resurrection of the dead. And so this is the picture we get it, but not too much about the life hereafter in the Dead Sea Scrolls, which is strange, but so it is.
How has history, during the period of the Jews being in the diaspora from Spain, how did that affect maybe their thinking about death and hoping that there is a life after because they had been so badly handled?
Well, the life hereafter, after the Jews were destroyed, the temple was destroyed, that was 70 of the Common Era, and the Jews went to exile, the life hereafter became more important.
Mm-hmm.
In the synagogue of the Orthodox Jewry, you repeat three times a day, God resurrects the dead. In the morning, you get up, you say, thank God you have returned my soul to me. And this went on for 2,000 years that the Jews were in exile. It, like you say, then it became even more the hope, if I suffer and I die, I will get to resurrect. The Rambam, who is like the highlight of Jewish history, you've probably heard him, Maimonides. He's this guy in Spain. He's the big authority. Now, he believed in the resurrection, and he gave you prayers for the resurrection. But then he said, oh, the immortality of the soul is also very important. And he said, like a double death, you'll die, you'll be resurrected, your soul will again be given back to you, and then you live again in the world to come, which you spoke about, and you live there for everlasting life.
Which, if you have been tormented by the Spanish Inquisition, it's very hopeful to think something like that will happen. On the other hand, let's talk about the various French philosophers who now started to have other ideas.
Right.
You mentioned about sparks almost, and I do remember reading and studying philosophy, André Maurois, who believed in sparks, that we all have a life spark, and when you die, the spark goes somewhere until it lands on another human, which of course is the theory of having another life.
Well, that is very similar. His thinking is similar to the thinking of the Kabbalah. The Kabbalah believed in sparks. There was this Rabbi Isaac Luria in the 16th century. Yeah. Now, continuing what you said, the Jews suffered. They were expelled from Spain. Here they went to Israel, then to Sephard. It wasn't called Israel, to Palestine. And they lived in Sephard. Now, this rabbi had this theory about the sparks. He believed in reincarnation of the soul, the transmigration of the soul going to another. And he believed that when God created the world, God was so great, so without an end, that the world splintered.
Yeah.
It like broke. And we call it Shvirat HaKelim, the breaking of the vessels. The vessels broke, and like you say, that philosopher said, he also said that sparks, we call them in Hebrew nitzotzot, spark, a spark, went and spread throughout the world. And he said, to bring what we talk in a modern sense, tikkun olam, he said it in his way, he said, these sparks were all holy and they're now scattered among not holy things.
Yeah.
Therefore, the job of every person is to do a good deed. And when you do a good deed, you bring a spark back, and that eventually will bring to redemption and to tikkun olam. So he also had your idea of sparks.
Yeah. It's interesting. It's almost a division. When France makes the Jews citizens and with the same rights, and Germany, it begins to say, all right, but secular. We don't want a separate nation from ours, so it's fine for you to have all of these. But in Germany, they start to have an organ, they start to have music, and they have almost like a Christian ceremony.
Right. Well, there came the modern age. Till the modern age, the Jews all believed in resurrection, immortality, all heaven.
Yeah.
When the modern age dawned and you had emancipation, the whole idea of religion was questioned. All these philosophers questioned it, by Jews, by non-Jews, everybody questioned. And then the whole idea of life hereafter, they stopped sort of believing in it and didn't think that it was possible. But it went on for quite a long time. The Jews changed, as you said, the Orthodox Jews remained the same.
Yeah.
The Reform and Conservative started to introduce different prayers.